everyone. Welcome. Hello. Welcome. I'd like to call the Cumberland School Committee meeting to order Thursday, April 3rd, 2017 at 7... I'm sorry, what did I say? April 13th, 2017 at 7:17 tonight. I apologize for us being a little late. We had to take care of some business. Could we all stand for the Pledge of Allegiance? Again, welcome. I apologize. We're in one meeting, then another meeting, and then this meeting. So I'm going to get settled in. Next item on the agenda is the approval of the agenda. Pleasure of the committee. Mr. Fiorillo makes a motion to approve. Do I have a second? Second by Mr. Denon. All in favor? Ayes have it, 6-0. I would like to state for the record that Mrs. Friedman is absent from this meeting tonight. Next item on the agenda is the approval of the consent agenda. Pleasure of the committee. Mr. Denon makes a motion to approve the consent agenda. Do I have a second? Second by Mrs. Goggin. All in favor? Ayes have it, 6-0. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is the report out of executive session meeting, which is item number A, report out of executive session meeting 329/17. There were no votes taken during that meeting. There was a vote to seal the minutes. Thank you. Mr. Denon makes a motion to seal minutes. Do I have a second? Second by Mr. Hess. All in favor? Ayes have it, 6-0. Next item is B, report out of executive session meeting 4/13/2017. I believe there were no votes taken in executive session. I'm looking for a motion for a vote to seal the minutes of that executive session. Pleasure of the committee. Mr. Hess makes a motion to seal the minutes. Do I have a second? Second by Mr. Denon. All in favor? Ayes have it, 6-0. Next item on the agenda is the superintendent's report. Mr. Mitchell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I know that Representative Ackerman is here this evening to share some information with the audience and specifically, I believe, the wrestling team and the basketball team, both of which were state champions. Representative Ackerman, would you like to go to the podium? Do you need some help?
I was going to send the vice chairman down, Mr. Denon. Representative Ackerman, yes. There we go. Oh, that's Mr. Denon. That's Mr. Denon.
You better send somebody else.
As always, it's a pleasure to be here tonight. All right, we're free mic'd. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm very excited that I have the opportunity to give you citations tonight on behalf of the state of Rhode Island for not only winning state champions, but apparently you have also been named the state team of the year. Woo! That is awesome, absolutely awesome. So I'm going to call you up alphabetically, if you would please come up and get your citation. Nicholas Ballas, come on up. Are you here? Okay, some of you aren't here. That's okay. We'll just put it aside for you. Coach Gordon will take care of that. Jeremy Batista. We have Joshua Blaze. Daniel Diacula. Gilly. Antonio Gianfrancesco. Please. We have Tyler Kelly. We have a few. Okay. Understandable. You have multi-sports going on. Okay, we have Adam Kulis. Jacob Matterlairs. Masterlairs, come on up. Alicio Neves. Dominic Passanante. Cameron Porcaro. We have Colby Riley. Malik Sangari. Darius Silva. Noah Tongas. Tongas. Vincent Tarara. Kareem Sangari. Jalen Reynolds. Okay, I'd also like to call up Mr. Colin Smith, assistant coach. And who could forget our own Steve Gordon, head coach. I also have citations for the basketball team. Are they here tonight? They are not here tonight, so I will leave the citations. And I'll tell you, it's an honor to be able to come here and give these to you because I get bragging rights up at the State House now. So there you go. Thanks. Have a great night. Nice to see you all.
All right. Good evening, everyone. Forgive me once again, school committee, for having my back to you. Just a couple of things that I'd like to add regarding the state championship that the wrestling team won. You know, I think out of all the teams, the really good teams that we have in the town of Cumberland, I get a chance to see the high school wrestling team more than anyone else because they practice in the trainer's gym every day. And just a couple of observations based on my experience over the last several years. Clearly, this is a well-coached, well-disciplined, hard-working team. And, you know, one of the things that we learn in life, and there is a connection between athletics and success in the competitive arena and life. There's no doubt in my mind that the reason that Cumberland High School are the state champions, state wrestling champions, is not only because they have a lot of talent, which you have to have, but I believe everybody has talent. And I think the difference is the hard work that you all put in every single day, the high expectations that your coaches have for you, and now the high expectations and the tradition that you all are a part of. You've heard me say many times, when you think about this, when you really think about this, how many champions do you know personally? We don't really know that many. And here's the beauty of being a state champion. It's 2017. You're the 2017 state champs. In 2050, you're still going to be the 2017 state champs. No one can take that away from you. So, congratulations on your successful season, and congratulations really for being a part of this incredible tradition. Now, I know that the chair of the school committee, Mr. Salvatore, wants to say something to you. But I know that Mr. Campanelli also has something that he would like to share with you as well. Do you want to go?
Hello, everyone. Thank you. We're going to do something a little unorthodox. Matt's going to bring in some mats, and the coach and I are going to, I'm going to show him some of my wrestling. Oh, maybe not. Maybe not. I don't want to show him up. I'm only kidding, coach. I'm only kidding. I just wanted to mention some stats. So the record. So everybody in the audience, the students sitting right here, this is what they accomplished. 14. So throughout the year, season highlights, 14-1 throughout the league, right? 21-4 overall dual meets. Is Cam Porcaro and Jack Hayes here? Oh, I apologize. They're individual state champions. So individual state champions. We all know the state champions of the RIIL state wrestling tournament, correct? But also this was impressive as well. So they scored. So after they won the team championships of the RIIL state wrestling tournament, they now get invited to the New England wrestling tournament, where there's hundreds of teams that they competed against, and you guys placed 10th. So that's awesome. That's excellent. 10th place out of hundreds of teams is extremely great. Second place, John Gorman Memorial Tournament, Cumberland, Rhode Island, out of 18 teams. Second place, Connecticut Challenge, Southern Connecticut, out of 16 teams. I mean, you guys continue to excel. The coaches continue to excel you. This is a positive influence when it comes to Cumberland sports in this committee, in this town. So I appreciate all your hard work. I'm sure everybody on the school committee appreciates your hard work. And it's great to have you here. Thank you very much. Hold on.
Just real quickly, I just wanted to add to all this. Obviously, people have said quite a bit about the accolades. And for me, as a younger side AD, even though I don't feel young anymore after a year and a half, but to have someone who's on my staff or on the staff here at Cumberland, who's coached a decade longer than I've been alive, give or take a year or two, is such an asset to me, because obviously it's hard to mentor someone who was your PE teacher, and you know, you still kind of cower when he walks in the room. So it's great for me to learn and grow. And his influence isn't just in the wrestling room. It obviously goes through other coaches and me as the leader here now and things like that. So I just quickly want to, these things kind of come across my desk sort of at odd times and looking for good moments to hand them out. So right around the late end of the season, right before the state tournament, I got something delivered to me through the school. And it was actually this organization, the National Federation of State High School Coaches Association. So it's a nationwide thing. And the state nominates a coach from every sport. So the Interscholastic League nominated our coach, Coach Gorin, to represent wrestling from our state. And then he was, you know, nominated for this award, which I'm sure he has a couple of these hanging on his walls, a couple in his, you know, bureau, a couple that he's filed away. But it's just another accolade that he earned this year, which is actually 2016. So this was given to him before he won the state title, the 2016 State Coach of the Year Boys Wrestling for the state of Rhode Island. So he's honored well beyond those things. So I just wanted to acknowledge that tonight. Thanks.
This is actually the part of the agenda where we get a chance to recognize students that we really like. The rest of the agenda is pretty boring. I'm only teasing, of course. Okay, so we would like to recognize some other students for their accolades. And I know, I'm hoping that at least a couple of them are here. I know that David Kapitinkin is here. David, can you please come up? And is Joseph De Silva here? No, and so we have three members of the senior class who have been recognized for the Presidential Scholars Program. Okay. So there are three seniors who are semifinalists in the Presidential Scholars Program. David is one, Joseph De Silva is another, and Lexi Evers, Alexandria Evers is the other. Let me just provide a little information about this Presidential Scholars Program, which is pretty impressive. The United States Presidential Scholars Program is a program of the Department of Education that recognizes the academic achievements of distinguished U.S. citizens graduating high school. It is described as one of the nation's highest honors for high school students in the United States of America. The program was established in 1964 by executive order of the President of the United States to recognize the most distinguished graduating seniors for their accomplishments in many areas, academic success, leadership, and service to school and community, and their personal growth journey. Each year, approximately 4,000 students apply. All three of our students, David, Joseph, and Lexi, all three are semi-finalists. There are only 500 semi-finalists chosen. All three of our students are semi-finalists. And a decision is made, I believe, sometime this month as to who the 161 presidential scholars from across the country will be. So we wish David well, and we thank him and the other two students, Joseph and Lexi, for representing Cumberland High School so well. Congratulations. Don't go anywhere. So we actually have, that's for this one. Okay, so David, don't go anywhere because they need you for something else. Wait till you hear this. I'm also pleased to announce that David is a National Merit Scholarship winner. And I know you're all thinking, oh, geez, that sounds pretty impressive. Well, it is incredibly impressive. Let me share this information with you. And by the way, David is also the valedictorian of the senior class. And are you going to Brown? Is that your choice? And he's also been accepted and will be attending Brown University in the fall. So, okay. So, we know that students take the PSAT, right? In fact, many of you have already taken the PSAT. Every year, about 1.6 million juniors and more than 22,000 high schools entered the 2017 National Merit Scholarship Program by taking the 2015 Preliminary SAT National Merit Scholarship Qualifying Test, that is the PSAT, which served as an initial screen for this program. To become a finalist, the semifinalist in his or her high school must submit a detailed scholarship application in which they provide information about the semifinalist's academic record, participation in school and community activities, demonstrated leadership abilities, employment, and honors and awards received. As I mentioned, David is a National Merit Scholarship winner. Now, let me just provide a little more detail about that. As I mentioned, 1.6 million students take the PSAT. Only 1% make it to the semifinalist level. Not only is he a semifinalist, he is a winner of the National Merit Scholarship Program. So just to give you some perspective, I was a high school principal for 12 years, and we had a lot of talented students in our school system, and we had students who were National Merit Scholar semifinalists. I don't believe we ever had a National Merit Scholar winner. You all have one here in Cumberland. So on behalf of the school committee and everyone associated with the Cumberland school system, David, congratulations on this outstanding honor. Congratulations.
Hey, so Bill Denon's your uncle, correct? Okay. Okay. All right. We're embarrassed. Congratulations. Thank you.
Okay. We have one more student that we would like to recognize. Jean Gennick, can you please come on up, Jean? How are you? All right, everybody, this is Jean Gennick. And let me explain why Jean is with us this evening, because we want to recognize her because she was a winner in the Donate Life Rhode Island High School Poster Contest. She was the winner of this contest. So this was a contest, everyone, to encourage organ and tissue donation in Rhode Island. Now, you're taking, what's the course that you're taking? Okay, so graphic design. She created, and let me show you the poster that she created. And if you're not organ donors, you'll better sign up. There is a wealth of information, which is really cool, which I'm sure it's why Jean won this competition. And it provides a wealth of information as to why it's important for all of us to be organ donors. If you're not an organ donor, please consider doing that. And it says organ and tissue donation. An organ donor can save 8 lives. No cost to the donor or family. There's no impact on funeral services. You can still have an open casket. People's heart, kidneys, lungs, pancreas, liver, intestines, corneas, skin, and tendons can be donated. All major religions in the United States support organ and tissue donation. So congratulations to you. Now, you were also, Gene, you were recognized today at a ceremony at the State House, right? And it said you won a prize. What was the prize?
I got an iPad Mini.
Well, congratulations. Thank you, Gene. And thank you for representing Cumberland High School in the Cumberland School District in such a fine manner. I think we're good.
David, could you hold on for a minute? Yeah, thank you. Sorry. Thank you, Mr. Mitchell. I did want to add something under this as well. I want to recognize. I apologize. Just coming up. Let me just. Are there any of the students here that attended the town council meeting at McCourt Middle School? Excellent. Could you guys stand up? Come right to the front. David, you as well. Come on up. We don't have a certificate for you this time, but come on up. Excellent. Yeah, right there. Right there is good. You can. Beautiful. I wanted to personally thank you for attending that meeting. And I had a couple things to say about it. Showing up to a meeting when you have 400 people sitting in the audience and you have to take that microphone, it's intimidating. I get intimidated still doing it. So I'm very proud of the courage that you guys displayed that night. And there was a couple things that somebody had explained to me when I was in college about public speaking and courage and political courage, and this one always stood out to me. And it's a little segment that I'm going to kind of paraphrase. President Kennedy, you've heard of John F. Kennedy, I'm sure. Right? He took a leave of absence from the Senate. Mr. Shaw, you probably know what I'm going to say. He took a leave of absence from the Senate in 1954 for back surgery. And it gave him the opportunity to study the topic of political courage. And that's exactly what everybody here displayed that night. The project resulted in a publication called Profiles in Courage. But what really stuck out during that was Ernest Hemingway, which was a famous actor, excuse me, right? Correct? Writer, author. He had a relative that was an actor, but I always get a little. All right, thank you. Now, I know Kennedy, I don't know Hemingway that much, but he made a comment. He said, "This is a book about the most admirable of human virtues, courage." You guys displayed great political courage. You went to that meeting. You stood up for what you believe in. David, I got to say personally, I like that you stood up there and you said, "I'm a voter." You know, that hits a lot of keys with a lot of people. And you know, we're all elected. We're just renting the seat. We had a former school committee member that said we're just renting the seat. And we're here for the people, by the people, to do what's right for this community. So I just wanted to thank you again for a show of applause. Thank you. Thank you very much. All right, we're going to take just a 30-second to 1 minute break. So if you guys want to clear out, and you got homework to do. Oh, that's right. It's vacation. Never mind. You can stay for the whole meeting. That's true. All right. On the agenda, Mr. Mitchell, did we have anything else under superintendent's report?
No, we're all set. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
So the next item on the agenda is the chairperson's report. Summary of the town levy formula presentation. Pleasure of the committee, before I speak, does anybody have anything to say in regards to the levy? Okay. Yep. Oh, I'm just giving anybody a chance to go first while I Just trying to dig up some documents. Coming down to the front. So we attended, I attended both of the meetings that they had on the levy. As I understand it, there's going to be a second part of the meeting next week that's going to be taking place where they will define what the levy vote is going to be and the percentage. As I want to say, I do appreciate the mayor stepping forward and starting to work with us, but I feel that the true leadership coming from the town is on the town council. I've seen a lot, almost every single town councilman step up, meet with us, myself, the administration of the schools, in trying to solve a problem. Again, it's not, you know, they're interested in long term. So I did want to commend the town council for stepping up. There were several town council members that did approach me, one of them being Councilor Scott Schmidt and Mr. Shaw, that's here in the audience, that they support a 4% levy increase. That would probably define, and again, I'm not sure exactly, but some of the funds possibly coming to the school to fill some holes and some gaps this year with additional funding going through next year. That's what the school needs. The school needs immediate action for this year and immediate action for next year. So I did want to thank the town council members for making it prevalent to me that they do support going forward with our schools within that levy. So I look forward to attending those meetings next week and walking up to the podium and saying some words of support to move us forward. So that's pretty much all I really needed to say. Anybody else on the committee? Okay. Excellent. Next item on the agenda is an update on pre-budget consultation of three-year forecasting with Cumberland Town Council. Mr. Prigliano, did you want to touch base on this? I had left this on here. Okay. At this point, fair enough. I leave it on just in case we had any discussion. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is reports of standing committees. Mr. DeMonica, payment of bills.
Mr. Chairman, Fiscal did meet upstairs tonight, and on a 3-0 vote, we are approving payment of the bills in the amount of $1,157,947.70, and I would make that as a motion to payment of bills.
Mr. DeMonica, one more time on that amount, please.
$1,157,947.70.
Thank you, Mr. DeMonica. Mr. DeMonica is making a motion on the floor for the payment of bills in the amount of $1,157,947.70. Do I have a second? Second by Mr. Fiorillo. All in favor? Ayes have it, 6-0. Next item on the agenda, Mr. DeMonica, Fiscal Management Subcommittee update.
Mr. Chairman, we did meet up tonight. We got an update from Sodesco Foods, and we are on track this year for the guarantee that we have in their contract. We also heard from a group from work camps. There's a couple of people here in the audience tonight about possibly using North Cumberland Middle School this summer. They bring about 400 people to the area, and they go out and they fix homes for the elderly, the disabled, the veterans, and so forth in the area. So they're asking for our permission to use our middle school in July, and we have some additional questions that we're going to ask of the police and fire, and the Dr. McGee from Woonsocket, how it worked with them, and they'll be on our agenda in 2 weeks as well. And we did get an updated budget forecast from Mr. Pignano, and we're on track still to cover that deficit. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. DeMonica. Next item on the agenda, Mr. Fiorillo, Policy and Procedures Subcommittee update.
Policy has not met over the last couple of weeks due to all the budget talks. We do look forward to starting up on April 25th.
Again. Thank you, Mr. Fiorillo. We can double check that, no problem. Next item on the agenda, Achievement and Communication Subcommittee update, Mr. Denon.
Mr. Chair, the Achievement and Communications Subcommittee has not met either. We've all been consumed by the budget, and we will be meeting again. We will be meeting in 2 weeks. One of the issues we think is going to be on that agenda is high school graduation requirements. Yeah, and I don't know if we worked out the details, but it's probably going to be a joint meeting between Mr. Fiorillo's subcommittee, which is the Policy and Procedures, and this committee, the Achievement and Communications Subcommittee, just because there's so much overlap between our two subcommittees regarding graduation requirements.
Thank you, Mr. Denon. Next item on the agenda is comments from the public. Anyone? I'd like to recognize Mr. Bob Shaw, town council member.
Mr. Chair and honorable committee members and superintendents, wanted to come here tonight to just continue my support for you guys, what you guys do, for starters, coming to our meetings, pledging your support for us. I believe that we are making strides as far as communication discussions go between the two groups. I do support the 4% increase in the levy, although I do not know what that means. 4% of what, you know, what's going to be the number? And I think we're going to find out shortly. But the point is that, you know, we're trying, you know, we recognize that there's a problem the recognition is coming on all levels, and we're trying. Maybe it's a little late in some people's eyes, but you know, better late than never. The other thing I want to be is I come to you as a parent of a child that attends elementary school at Cumberland Hill, also as the town rep for that area. The vandalism that is occurring at Cumberland Hill has been an ongoing thing, as most of you know, back to when I was on the PTO. And, you know, there needs to be some sort of answer to that. The vandalism, the trash, just the destruction of property. And I know that we've had some ideas thrown around between myself, the principal, but I think that there's something that can be done, and I'd like to propose that I encourage that we do something. I'll send an email out of what my proposal is to the committee, and you guys can discuss it and give me any feedback you have. But I'm concerned, and that, you know, we keep replacing things and doing with that. It just doesn't make sense why we can't have some sort of deterrent for that area. So I come to you tonight with that in mind, and look forward to next Wednesday night. So thank you.
Mr. Shaw, thank you. Anyone else? Comments from the public? Hello? David? Welcome.
My name is Dave Dansereau. I reside at 26 Gilbert Court with my three children and my wife, and I'm honored to live there with her. She's the rock star nurse from Cumberland Hill Elementary School. By the way, she gave, in my biased opinion, some great public comment and testimony earlier this week at the town council meeting. All the nurses in the district actually are rock stars, by the way, but I think we all know that here. I actually had to watch that replay as I told her I would be there for support, and then at the last minute I had to leave to pick up my daughter at work, so I told her I had her back, and then I exited promptly, but I watched the replay and saw that she really, I think, hit the nail. I'll make this brief, and my comments I'd actually like to share tonight, I intended them to be shared at the council meeting earlier, and I was hoping that, I appreciate Mr. Shaw being here this evening, and I was hoping that the mayor might actually hear these comments as well, so perhaps someone will watch that replay of this event tonight. But I wanted to mainly come here tonight to thank you all, school members here, and the committee, and administration, for all your incredible energy and the time you've put into this this important educational issue that we have at hand. We're really doing this for our young, bright minds, as we all know. And the students in the Cumberland School District may not be, at this time, losing as much sleep as many of us are. But what we do here in addressing these issues and in thinking about possible solutions are so important to the future of our students in the town. I just wanted to really tell you a quick story, but I wanted to set the stage before doing that. Last week when we quickly filled up the library community room and we were making our way out of that great complex we have there in town, many of you might not have noticed on the right, there's a memorial to our veterans. And you may not notice that, but because it was certainly dark, but every time I go by there, I certainly do. Most of you are probably unaware that my father had a hand as a Mason in building that memorial. And as a veteran of the Korean War and Cumberland employee of the Highway Department, he was the unofficial town Mason later in his career. And he had a hand in that job of building that memorial meant so much to my dad. Excuse me. He also, for many years, was a Union Mason prior to that and built many of the schools in neighboring Massachusetts. At the time, as a kid, when my dad left the Masons Union to take a pay cut and work for the town, I couldn't understand why he would do that. My father took great pride in having a hand at the building of that cobblestone memorial. He and many of his co-workers on the Cumberland Highway Department worked together to build a lasting memorial in town that we all could take pride in, and some 30 plus years later, we still do. Although today my dad's hardworking hands are now at rest, his memorial lives in that work. Just like the work you all are doing now for the town, your efforts today will impact the memories and the opportunities our children have for our town in the future. My dad would take me to that memorial on weekends as a kid to show me the work that was underway and to show me the progress he and his co-workers, who he considered his friends as well, the progress they had made that week. I remember I would ask him how he could visualize the project and how he could possibly keep it all level. He'd say there was certainly some give and take between his co-workers whose design they were going to follow. But in the end, they could work it out. And he emphasized, as he always did with all his projects, that the importance of a good foundation as a start. He would say, you can't go wrong with a good foundation. That memorial still stands. And although one or two of those cobbles are now missing, because the building still stands strong and the memorial still stands strong because of the foundation was set level, so it can be repaired. We have a great foundation and a talent and a commitment from our great teachers and leaders to prepare our students to dream great things and be successful builders. We just need to have the investment to make the repairs, but the return on that investment will be lasting. From the energy and the community shown over the last few weeks, I now realize why my dad wanted to work for this great small town and why so many former graduates come back to teach the next generation of Clippers here. I could go into a song, but I'll skip that. I'm John Cougar, small town. Today, I tell all my patients and the work I do to repair their bodies. And I tell them, if you are not building, then you are breaking down. So let's keep planning to build and add staff and grow to offer the best opportunities that this new world economy will require our kids to be ready for. I want to thank you, and I assure you I'll do my part. I'll continue to work with the Health and Wellness Subcommittee and hopefully lend some suggestions and work with the newly formed Strategic Planning Committee and Task Force as well. I'm also planning on going to get approval from the mayor's office to volunteer to repair those missing cobblestones. using my dad's tools. I'll even provide the mortar and a few cobblestones for free to seal the deal. Have a good night and thank you.
Excellent, David. Thank you. Next item on the agenda. I'm sorry, anyone else for public comment? I will call public comment closed. Next item on the agenda is new business. Discussion and or vote to approve overnight student field trip. Grade 8 middle school students, Quebec City, January 2018. Mr. Mitchell.
Madam Brady is here to once again ask you for your support in going once again to Canada.
Hello, Madam Brady.
Bonsoir, messieurs, dames. Je suis là, c'est moi, encore. Don't worry, I'm not going to get the whole
presentation. Buongiorno, come sta? Oh, wait, that's Italian. Good morning.
So we are looking for approval to run our 21st annual trip to Quebec. As usual, we like to go during the Martin Luther King weekend in January to get the full effect of the cold weather that can be found in Canada at that time of year. Keeps them on their toes, keeps them busy. And I have sent the request to Mr. Mitchell, who has graciously accepted that request and put his blessings to it. So you have the packet that has all of the information. Really not too many major changes this year. The cost has gone up nominally, about a $10 cost increase if we have the same number of students that have participated over the past several years. We've been at about 170, 182, somewhere in that number. And if we get the buses full to that level, then we get that cost savings. The only way we could realize an additional cost savings is if we really either had a whole lot more students that went or a whole lot more less students that decided to participate. The itinerary is very similar to previous years, and I will gladly answer any questions that you might have.
Thank you. I do have a couple of questions. Just gauge in the attendance, how do you think it's going to fall from last year?
I think it will be comparable or better attended because we have a larger class.
For the record, that's Mrs. Coughlin, principal of North Cumberland Middle School. All right, so you have about 45 more students attending that grade that's representative of them possibly going on the trip. Excellent. I did briefly look at the material that was submitted. Are there, can you just highlight maybe a reason for a couple of the changes that you have?
There have been several policy changes over the past couple of years so that we used to do much more free time in the city where students were allowed on their own. And we found that last year was very successful to have more of our lunches provided by the tour company to eliminate that time within the city. We would like to request a waiver from the committee for one luncheon to have the students that travel, they go within a two-block radius. It's very, very challenging for us as chaperones to keep track of or be with our group of 10 students because a lot of the stores don't allow us into the store. So we would like to seek permission to have that particular luncheon be the way that it has been done in the past where the students are, the chaperones are all within that two-block radius, the tour guides are all within that two-block radius, and the students have their choice of lunch venues, and they have their choice of shopping, and it's for a very limited amount of time. And there are plenty of adults, but it is very, very difficult to be traveling that two-block radius with the narrow sidewalks with 10 or 12 kids, immediately in our control and within our sight, basically, which we tried to do this past year. It was very challenging. And then, so we do have some lunches that were very successful at a new venue. some meals that we're going to try to do at different places, but it's really just minor changes like that on the part of the tour company, one or two activities that they'd like us to try a different activity to see how we like it and see if we want to make that a part of our events in the future. But they're really minor changes in terms of the itinerary.
Dog sledding, hotel, ice hotel, that's all.
All staying. On the docket.
Sugar Shack, yeah. Excellent. Beautiful. Okay. Pleasure of the committee? Any questions? Mr. Denon? Mr. Motions, making a motion on the floor to approve. I'm sorry, Mr. Denon. I said Mr. Denon made a motion.
Making a motion.
I apologize. Mr. Denon is making a motion to approve the grade 8 middle school students Quebec City trip January 2018. Do I have a second? Second by Mrs. Goggin. All in favor? Ayes have it. 6-0. Congratulations. We look forward. I'm sorry, Mr. Hess.
I just wanted to say I hope your students are inspired to visit during the non-winter months. I was able to go to Quebec this past summer with my family. It's pretty amazing when it's green as well. And the Montmorency Falls, when they're actually running, are quite impressive. It's quite beautiful, and not to boast, but I did make it up those stairs in 3 minutes and 50 seconds, so I'll just throw that out for anybody. You can't do that during the winter, but it really is.
Thank you. Yeah, we do often have students that come back years later that tell us that they were inspired to go back to the city. We have students that can't attend the trip for whatever reason that travel, with their families. So yes, it very much inspires them. We have students years later that tell us that it was a transformative experience for them. So appreciate it.
Thank you. We look forward to the highlights when you come back and the samples from the Sugar Shack. And I'm sorry. All right. So we have a motion. We have a second. All in favor? Ayes have it. 6-0. Congratulations. Thank you. Okay, we get a lot of excitement up here. Next item on the agenda is the Cumberland High School Chorus National Festival of the States revised dates, April 2018. Mr. Mitchell.
Mr. Chairman, this is a minor request. Ms. Ducharme is requesting that the trip be moved up a week. So rather than April 12th and 15th through the 15th of 2018, she's requesting that the trip take place on April 5th through the 8th, 1 week earlier.
Okay, excellent. Pleasure of the committee. Thank you, Mr. Fiorello. Mr. Fiorello has a motion to accept the requested trip guidelines. Do I have a second? Second by Mr. Denon. All in favor? Ayes have it. 6-0. Thank you, Mr. Mitchell. Next item on the agenda, discussion and or vote to approve building use request work camps group mission trips. Mr. DeMonica.
Mr. Chairman, we did hear this upstairs. A couple of gentlemen here can speak about it, but we're gathering additional information. We tabled it upstairs in fiscal for 2 weeks, and I think these gentlemen would like to speak a little bit, and then we would, I would move that we table this as well to our next meeting.
Thank you, Mr. DeMonica. Gentlemen, welcome. If you would like to give a little bit of an update to the full committee in the audience, please.
Summer, and we're seeking use of the school to house our volunteers for 1 week, the week of the 23rd through the 29th of July. And as was mentioned, there's some questions that need to be answered, but at this point I just wanted to offer time if there anything that had come up since that meeting earlier today. If not, that's fine. We have our marching orders. We know what we need to kind of take care of, and we're anxious to meet again in 2 weeks. So at this point, just wondered if there's anything else that came up.
Thank you.
I mean, that was it, and we'll see you in 2 weeks. And
great. Okay. Yeah,
thank you.
Thanks again for the opportunity.
Thank you, gentlemen. Have a good night.
Mr. Mr. Chairman, I make a motion we table this for 2 weeks.
Thank you, Mr. DeMonica. Mr. DeMonica has a motion to table the work camps, second by Mr. Hess. All in favor? Ayes have it, 6-0. Next item on the agenda, discussion and or vote to approve revised 2016-2017 school calendar. Mr. Mitchell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We just wanted to let you all know that we had to adjust the school calendar for the 16-17 school year because of the snow days. So the last day of school for students will be on Monday, June 19th, and the last day of school for teachers will be Tuesday, June 20th. And again, those days, the end of school was pushed back due to the weather.
Thank you. Mr. Mitchell, what was the last day that teachers?
The 20th.
Pleasure of the committee. Mr. DeMonica makes a motion to approve the revised 2016-2017 school calendar. Do I have a second? Second by Mr. Fiorillo and Mrs. Goggin. All in favor? Ayes have it, 6-0. Next item on the agenda is the update on kindergarten and first grade open registration days. Mr. Mitchell, before I pass this over to you, I can say I happened to be here for a meeting during the open registration days, and the line was for kindergarten was up the stairs, up the second stairs, in starting to go up the third flight of stairs. So it seemed to me that it was pretty successful. I was told some numbers, but I look forward to hearing some of that, Mr. Mitchell.
Well, just very quickly, Mr. Chairman, we did have more kindergarten registrations this year during the two-day registration period. The total this year was 223. Last year during the same two-day period, there were 206. So there were additional students enrolling during that, which is probably why, for the first time, there was a line, as you mentioned, up the stairs. So we'll have to take that into consideration moving forward. But they all of the school staff involved in that process, they're efficient, and we're able to get that line down in an efficient manner. So we are anticipating, per our historical data regarding additional kindergarten registrations, we're anticipating that there will be at least another 100 or so registrations between now and the start of the school year. So we'll be watching the number of registrations closely so that we make sure that we have enough teachers to teach those students when they arrive in August.
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell. I'd also like to say it was very exciting because everybody's in the line with their children. The registration desk was very organized. You have OCYL going through their programs. You had Jenny from Alphabet. She's got kids coloring. The parents are in line filling out paperwork. It was nice to see. It was exciting. It's good to see the kids running around and the parents of this community, so involved. So thank you, Mr. Mitchell. Next item on the agenda, discussion and or vote to approve resolutions SC. Actually, Mr. Adams, could I take these out of order? Could I do the second one first, or no, do them as they're listed? Okay. I'm going to skip ahead, and I'm going to move over to item number 2 under E, SCR 2017-03, Resolution on Gun-Free Zones. I believe we do. So if the committee has any questions, I'm going to briefly go through the resolution, but we also have somebody here. I apologize if you could step up to the podium and state your name, please.
My name is Nan Rue, and I'm the secretary of the Rhode Island Coalition Against Gun Violence, which is the sponsor of the resolution.
Excellent. Thank you. I know you and I did converse via email, and I did converse also with somebody on your board, Peter.
Pete. Bilderback.
Yes. Excellent. And your knowledge and his knowledge on this topic was very convincing. And I think is very important to this committee. Could you give us a quick synopsis on your resolution?
Certainly.
Or on the resolution that we're proposing?
Correct. This is a resolution to support the bill which has been introduced into the General Assembly, which would take care of a contradiction which now exists under the general laws of the state of Rhode Island. And the contradiction is that schools are designated under 1147-60 as gun-free schools, gun-free zones. However, under another state law which existed prior to the designation of the schools as gun-free zones, there is a law 1147-11 which gives anyone who holds a permit to carry concealed the right to carry weapons everywhere. And that word is used in the law itself. What we propose to do with the bills that have been introduced, and we have quite a number of sponsors on these bills, so we're feeling pretty good about their being passed this year. They've been in committee and not allowed to be out for the past 3 years. But the difference would be simply allowing schools to have, if they choose, armed peace officers who would be well-trained law enforcement officers. We feel that having parents, teachers, administrators, volunteers coming into the schools with concealed weapons and not, they have no requirement to alert administration that they are bringing guns into schools. And school property, by the way, includes sports fields and school buses. We know things can get pretty heated in on the sports field. I have grandchildren that I go and watch their games, and I see and I find myself even getting riled up when I think a referee hasn't called a fair, made a fair call on my grandson. So I know that those situations can get intense. We feel that having a gun on the school grounds in a situation escalates that situation, can escalate it. We have also heard about, there are studies that the FBI has done and other organizations which do show that there are accidents in schools with concealed weapons that are allowed on. When you think about it, in homes, we ask parents to store the guns without their ammunition in a locked cabinet of some kind. If a school were brought into, if a gun were brought into the school, it would probably be in a desk or a purse or a pocketbook or a pocket. And this does not allow it to be secured. And there's all the children in the area would certainly be at risk for an accidental discharge or something along those lines. So we're hoping that the school committee will agree. And so far we have 19 school committees in Rhode Island which have adopted this resolution. And we're hoping that Cumberland will make it number 20.
Thank you. You know, I can say that, especially for me, my immediate knee-jerk reaction is if we put a gun in an administrator's hands, and Superintendent Mitchell and I had a discussion about this as well. It just a recent case in the media was a teacher at a school, and her husband showed up and pulled a gun and shot her. And one student died, and one was injured from, you know, ricochet or the misuse of that gun. So what if, I mean, what if an administrator had a weapon and was stopping someone and it got out of control and an innocent child got hit as well? So at this point, I do feel that moving forward with this resolution is a good thing for Cumberland and for the state of Rhode Island. So, pleasure of the committee. Mr. Denon makes a motion to approve SCR 2017-03, Resolution of Gun-Free Schools. Do I have a second? Second by Mr. Fiorello. All in favor? Ayes have it, 6-0. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Have a great night. Thanks for sticking around. Next item on the agenda is SCR 2017-02A, Limiting the Growth of Charter School Expansion Merrill Academies. before we're going to get into this a little bit, but I'm going to share some stats on how or what my reasoning was on putting forward this resolution. excuse me. As everyone knows, and this committee knows, the expansion of the Merrill Academies in Cumberland is moving forward and becoming more crippling to our budget, to the resources that we're trying to maintain within the school. Some of the numbers, and Alex Pregliano's not here, but charter schools have grown. So in fiscal year 2008, we were paying roughly $125,000. As of right now, I believe our number, from what I'm looking at this, is right around the tune of $3.4 million. That's 27 times greater from 2008 to right now in just 9 years. So the growth of the Merrill Academy is just overwhelming. They were always looking for real estate, always looking to expand within Cumberland. We have to maintain the integrity of this school system. I do not believe we need a parallel school system to replicate us. This is the town's largest asset. It needs to be protected. So this resolution represents that. I will read on the some portions of the resolution. Skipping down to the bottom, now, therefore, let it be resolved. The Cumberland School Committee requests that the Cumberland Town Council pass a resolution asking the Rhode Island General Assembly to pass legislation limiting the further expansion or increase in enrollment of the Blackstone Academy Prep Merrill Academy, Blackstone Merrill Academy, or any other charter or non-traditional public school located in the town of Cumberland, and withholding any written support for any proposed charter or non-traditional public school that would draw students from the town of Cumberland or would otherwise require the Cumberland School Department to pay tuition because any such expansion or proposed charter or non-traditional public school would be contrary to the fiscal and education welfare of the municipality and students of the town of Cumberland. Pleasure of the committee.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion we approve this resolution.
Mr. DeMonica makes a motion to approve SCR 2017-02A. Do I have a second? Mr. Fiorillo has a second for a discussion. Mr. Fiorillo.
Mr. Chairman, I would make a motion to amend the resolution so that on the last paragraph, I would insert the following language after the word legislation. My language would be allowing all municipalities, or at least the town of Cumberland, to set the number or percentage of the municipality's students who are permitted to attend charter or non-traditional public schools. And I would also further to delete the remainder of that paragraph.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Fiorillo. I would also like to add a little bit more discussion to that as well, but okay. Thank you, Mr. Denham makes a second for discussion on the content that Mr. Fiorillo added. I did miss earlier when I was speaking, I did want to say that as of right now, there's Cumberland has 532 students going to a charter school. We have 4,503. This represents 11.81% of the students in Cumberland that go to charter schools. So. That's all I really wanted to say. So we have a motion by Mr. Denon, correct? A motion by Mr. Fiorillo, second by Mr. Denon. Any further discussion? Mr. Denon?
In the past few weeks, we've talked a lot about the budget, and we've talked to people all over town, and we hear from people all the time. And every conversation I've had, almost every conversation is, what are we going to do about the charters in town? This is something we can do to request some relief. I think the change that Mr. Fiorillo made, basically we're asking for the town council to, for permission to have the town council set the number of students that can go to the charter schools. I think this is a good thing because it gives us, gives the town, not us, but gives the town more control over our destiny. And that's why I support it.
Thank you, Mr. Denon. All in favor? Ayes have it, 6-0.
Now, at this point, the amendment proposed by Mr. Fiorello has been approved. So if the resolution as amended is going to be approved or not, I'm not on the committee, that's okay. Up to you. Then there needs to be a motion to approve or not approve the amended resolution.
Pleasure of the committee. I'm looking for a motion to approve Mr. Fiorello's changes.
I would make a motion to approve the amended
resolution. Mr. Fiorello has a motion to approve the amended resolution. Do I have a second? Second by Mr. DeMonica and Mrs. Goggin. All in favor? Ayes have it, 6-0. Mr. Mitchell, could we please make sure that the town council receives this resolution ASAP? Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, could we get copies in our drive as well, the corrected one?
Yes, we'll make sure. Mr. Mitchell, could you please make sure that the modified version of this resolution is put in our drives?
Will do. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Next item on the agenda is the personnel recommendations. Mrs. Fogel.
Good evening. So I just have a few, I just have a few for you this evening. I have one resignation. I request the advice and consent on the resignation of Kathleen Matau, junior varsity softball coach at Cumberland High School, effective March 20th of 2017. Do you want me to just do them all and then? Okay. I have a leave of absence. I request the advice and consent of the school committee on the FMLA leave of absence of Michelle Capello, reading specialist at McCourt Middle School, with an anticipated leave date of May 8th, 2017, through the end of the 2017 school year. I request the advice and consent of the school committee on the appointment of Cesarina Maria Hernandez, Spanish educator at North Cumberland Middle School, effective January 23rd, 2017. This is a part-time position. She's a step two. Just for clarification, if you remember correctly, we had added a 0.5 back in September. That person abruptly resigned. We've had this person in as a long-term sub to try her out with the stipulation that if it worked out that I would appoint her to her start date. So that's what that's it. So I just want you to know that. And lastly, I have a coaching appointment of Kevin McGuire, who will be the JV softball coach, and his start date was March 27th.
Thank you, Mrs. Fogel. Pleasure of the committee. Mr. Denon makes a motion to accept Mrs. Fogel's recommendation. So I have a second. Second by Mr. Hess. All in favor? Ayes have it, 6-0. Thank you, Mrs. Fogel. Next item on the agenda, school committee comments, school liaison reports.
Chairman.
DeMonica.
I'd just like to thank everybody who came out to these town council meetings the last couple of weeks, and that you continue to come out. Never in my wildest dream when I said we need to shut down town hall at this meeting that we shut down town hall and the library and got everyone to McCourt. And you know, we took them out of their comfort zone, and that's good. And this is all about the children. And hopefully the town councils that have talked to us will support us down the road here and make a plan for the funding of the schools. But I just want to thank everyone for coming out.
Thank you, Mr. DeMonica. Anyone else? Mr. Fiorillo?
Yes, I would also like to thank all the parents and school supporters that have turned out over the last couple of weeks, and hopefully they'll be able to attend next week's meeting. And also the meetings that will then take place for the next budget, which is only, you know, several weeks away. I do take exception, though, to one thing that happened at that meeting, and that was the so-called levy workshop conducted by Mr. Parmalee, the new town's finance director. I do not know Mr. Parmalee. I don't know his background, but quite honestly, I know that Mr. Parmalee had made an apology to the town council regarding his presentation. I believe that Mr. Parmalee also owes the school committee and the school department an apology as well. What was supposed to be a workshop to explain how the levy works and what action could be taken at this time of the calendar year turned into, quite honestly, a criticism of the way that the school department has run its business. And for somebody that's only been here for 5.5 weeks, I think it was completely out of line. And his information, although some of it was factually correct, was not actually correct. Some of his comments about how we did not take advantage of the lighting project that the town is doing is just not true. We tried working with the town in fiscal. We actually tabled our resolution to do our parking lot lights here at CHS, I believe twice, to try to get more information from the town. They were not able to provide it. They just kept on saying it was 6 months down the road. We weren't able to get any kind of specifications on what kind of lights would be used. We had, quite honestly, a safety problem up here with the lack of lighting, and we took advantage of it. And I actually had met with the mayor to find out what his feelings on it were, and he was fine with it as long as we were saving money. And our lighting project, which is underway, will be paid off in 5 years from just the savings alone. So that is a good project. We have constantly and consistently looked for savings. We will be looking at solar energy over the next several months to see what savings would be able to be realized from that. We are always looking for the best price on everything from paper clips to natural gas. So to give the impression to the public that we're just spending money willy-nilly is just really, quite honestly, reprehensible. And again, Mr. Parmalee owes us an apology.
Mr. Fiorello, well said. Thank you. Mr. Hess?
I'll echo everyone else's comments. I think it was great to see the parents and the teachers and the students especially. I think it speaks a lot to what we're able to accomplish in our schools, that we had students get up in front of 400 or 500 people and articulate, in some cases better than some of our some of the adults did, what they were feeling and what they wanted to accomplish. I also agree, as a taxpayer, I think Mr. Parmalee's presentation was not what I was looking for out of that. I wanted to see what the town was going to do. Certainly, I'm interested in what my taxes are going to be, and I didn't get any useful information out of that presentation. So that was disappointing. I also think, as we talk about this, Mr. Parmalee mentioned the need to look at this from multiple different angles, from additional state aid as well as additional revenue and savings. I echo Mr. Fiorello's comments that I don't think he fully realizes that in order for us to accomplish the things that we have as a district with the limited funds that we've had for the duration that we have been saving. And I think it's a little bit of an affront to us to say that we need to come to the table again. Certainly, we are always in a savings mode. We are always looking for additional ways to maximize taxpayer dollars. But the inference there is that there's a lot of money to be saved in our budget, and I just don't think that is accurate with how lean our budget is run. So I've said this before, and I'll say it again, Cumberland does not have a spending problem. It has a revenue problem, and you cannot save your way out of a revenue problem. So I think people need to be aware of that. I'd also like to thank Dr. Masterson for being such a gracious host on two occasions, one impromptu and one planned. I think McCourt was a great venue for that, and I think things went very well there.
Excellent. Thank you, Mr. Hess. Very well said. Anyone else? There's a couple things I would like to add. If Marion Rowe sent out a Cumberland School volunteer invitation It represents their 50th anniversary for the Cumberland School Volunteer. And she told me today she's going to have one of the original founders of the school volunteers there. I believe she's in her 80s. I apologize. I don't know her. I wrote it down on another piece of paper. This event is on May 4th, 2017. The donation ticket is $10. It's at the Lusitania Club. Starts at 6:30. I think it's a great event, and I think if you can attend, I would definitely go forward and attend. Marion Roll has been a great advocate and for the Cumberland Volunteers within the Cumberland Schools, and I think she does wonderful stuff. The other thing that I have is, I was hoping Rep. Ackerman was going to be here. She's working on a House Resolution Number 6035, sponsored by herself, Rep. McNamara, Blazajowski, Bennett, and Amore. It's entitled A House Resolution Extending the Reporting and Expiration Dates and Amending the Membership of the Special House Commission that Studies the Presence and Treatment of Lead in Drinking Water in the State of Rhode Island. She advised me that this committee meets several times a year, and it's currently 8 members. They do not have a voting rank, but they have research and advisement. She's moving it to 9, and she's going to pick somebody from the schools or from the school committee to chair that, to not chair it, but to be on that committee. So in light of current situation from having lead in our water, she thought it would be important to have somebody from the schools represent that committee as well, which I think is great. So I wanted to thank her for that. It did go forward, get approval to move forward last night, so now it's going in front of the whole House, and I'll keep everybody up to date on that. So, and that's all I have to add. Mr. Mitchell, do we have executive session?
No, we don't.
Or are we going to turn into pumpkins?
I think we're good.
All right. Thank you. Next item on the agenda. Mr. Fiorillo has a motion to adjourn. Do I have a second? Second by Mr. Hess. All in favor? Ayes have it. Thank you. Have a good night.